stand together and we'll sing, "We Have Come Into His House," hymn number 224. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship Christ the Lord. Worship him, Christ the Lord. Let's forget about ourselves and magnify his name and worship him. Let's forget about ourselves and magnify his name and worship him. Let's forget about ourselves, magnify his name and worship Christ the Lord. Worship him, Christ the Lord. You can be seated.
Good morning. We do have a number of announcements to do this morning. Wanted to, first of all, before we get to the
there we go. Now you can hear me. Wanted to let you know before we get to the announcements this morning that the altar flowers this morning have been shared with us by Carlita and Susan. They are in remembrance and recognition of their aunt, Alice White, who passed away this past week. So Carlita, thank you for sharing that with your church family. We certainly appreciate that. Wanted to, of course, remind you through the announcements here that our offering basket continues to be at the back door. Your giving has just continued to impress everybody, I think. The fact that you're continuing to give, to support all the different ministries, the missions that our church supports, that we've been involved in over the last couple of years, thank you so much for your continued giving so that we can continue to support those who are working here at the food pantry, or whether in Slovenia or Iraq or wherever our missionaries are. Thank you so much for the work, for the giving that you continue to give so that the work can continue to be done. Communion cups are in the foyer. Hopefully you picked one up. If not, let Bill know and he can get one to you. I think we'll do that this morning. Sam's not here to stop me, so we'll do that. I feel free. Just joking, Sam. I know you're really watching me. Sorry. Trail Life and American Heritage Girls are meeting this afternoon. They have come back to meeting in person again. So I encourage you, as I do every time that Trail Life Girls, American Heritage, or Trail Life Boys and American Heritage Girls are meeting, I encourage you, if you're out and about this afternoon, swing by the church around 4:30, 4. Take a look at what it looks like to have both of those groups here at our church running around. It's so much fun. An impromptu kickball game broke out last week. So I'm not sure it was supposed to, but it was a lot of fun. I encourage you to swing by and take a look and see what that looks like. Ash Wednesday Discipleship Study is coming up this Wednesday. We will be here in the Fellowship Hall for Discipleship Study, and we will also be recognizing Ash Wednesday in the beginning of the Lenten season. Zoom meeting will be available for that. So if you want to join by Zoom, I encourage you to do so. Not sure how we're going to do Ash Wednesday by Zoom, but we'll figure that out somehow or another. Bethel Women's Retreat has been scheduled for April the 22nd through the 24th. There are details, I'm sure, that some of you are probably wondering about. Cameron, do you have any details this morning? No details from Cameron. If you have any questions, you can talk to her after the service, I'm sure. Absolutely. General conference is coming next month. I know we had our local church conference just last week, but our general conference with all of the churches combined will be hosted by the Bethel Methodist Hill Country Church, just north of San Antonio. Where Sam and Susan are this morning, as a matter of fact. So I make plans now. I know that before too long, in the next couple of weeks or so, we will be getting different notifications from them about where to stay, places that you can go in that area when you're down there. So we will certainly be passing that information along to you as we get it. Be in prayer for both of those things throughout this next week, for the women's retreat as well as for general conference, as both of those things are on the horizon and coming up, and they'll be here before we know it. As always, you can keep in touch with the things going on around Robinson Bethel Methodist and all of the Bethel Methodist churches through our website, bethelmethodist.com. You can look for us specifically at /Robinson, and you'll find us there. As we finish up our announcements, as we move into our service this morning, I do want to just simply say what a tremendous blessing it is to be able to join together in worship. Whether you're here in person this morning, whether you're joining us online, whether you'll be watching this at a later date through the website, through YouTube, whatever it is, but thank you so much for coming together this morning, for responding to God's voice, for hearing Him call us together, and for coming to this place, gathering here in His name to worship Him. Let's pray. Father, I remember the words of the psalmist who said, "It is good for us to gather at the house of God." This morning, Father, it is good for us to be here in this place. This past week, Lord God, with all of the stuff that we had to deal with, whether it was funeral things or whether it was illness, whether it was doctor's visits or just the cloudiness and the ice and the yucky weather, whatever it was that we faced this past week, Father, we thank you for today. We thank you that we are here in this place, able to gather together with other believers, able to know, Lord God, that you, the faithful one, the God who says, "Where two or more are gathered in my name, I will be with them." Father, you are here. Just as you are with us when we leave this place, Father, today as we come here, you join us. You prepared us. You prepared us for this already. You brought us through this past week. You brought us to this moment so that, Lord God, we can recognize the fact that you are indeed the holy God, the God who loves, the God who provides for, the God who deals with and corrects at times, the living God, the God who speaks. Help us today, Father, to hear your voice and to respond to your voice. In Jesus' name.
Let's stand together. We'll sing hymn number 33, "Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise."
Immortal, invisible, God only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes. Most blessed, most glorious, the Ancient of Days, Almighty, victorious, thy great name we praise. Unresting, unhastening, and silent as light, nor wanting, nor wasting, thou rulest in might. Thy justice is mountains high soaring above, thy clouds which are fountains of goodness and love. To all life thou givest, to both great and small, in all life thou livest, the trust life of all. Thy wisdom so boundless, thy mercy so free, eternal thy goodness, for naught changeth thee. Great Father of glory, pure Father of light, Thine angels adore thee, all veiling their sight. All praise we would render, oh, help us to see. 'Tis only the splendor of light hideth thee.
Psalm 99. The Lord reigns, let the people tremble. He dwells between the cherubim, let the earth be moved. The Lord is great in Zion. He is high above all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. He is holy. The king's strength also loves justice. You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his footstool. He is holy. Moses and Aaron were among his priests, and Samuel was among those who called upon his name. They called upon him, the Lord, and he answered them. He spoke to them in the cloudy pillar. They kept his testimonies and the ordinances he gave them. You answered them, O Lord our God. You were to them God who forgives, though you took vengeance on their deeds. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy hill, for the Lord our God is holy. Let's sing hymn number 3. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, wed in three persons, Blessed Trinity. Holy, 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 all the saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. Cherubim and seraphim falling down before thee, which Wert and art and evermore shall be. Holy, 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 though the darkness hide thee, though the eye of sinful man thy glory may not see, only thou art holy. There is none beside thee, perfect in power, in love and purity. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, holy, merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Let's remain standing for the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is sitting at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And from there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Be seated.
So, before we pray, I have a quick question. Has anybody seen my sermon? I know I had a stack of them. Jack has one. Are there multiple copies there, or is that just one? Okay. You're Bill. Bill, do you see any extras laying around there? There should be a stack of sermons. Maybe I left them over here where I normally leave one for the flanges. I just realized I don't have it with me. They're somewhere, I promise. Bill will find them. I didn't leave any over there. All right. Oh, we might have to borrow that one before that goes to Mr. Gene if we don't find it. He'll get a used copy, I guess, but there you go. All right, thank you. Thank you for putting up with your absent-minded preacher. As we go to prayer this morning, we do have a number of folks that I want to bring to your attention. First of all, of course, we have those who continue to go through the grieving, the mourning process. We continue to pray for Carlita and for Susan, for their family, for the White family, as they grieve, as they mourn the loss of Alice. We pray for Bill. I was kind of hoping that he would be here this morning, but I completely understand that he's not. Pray for Bill as he adjusts to a brand new way of life. We have a number of folks in our church who understand what that's like, and so we certainly want to pray for him during this time. We have a number of other people. What is that one entitled? That'd be me. That'd be it. Wait, maybe. Yeah, that's it. Thanks, Bill. Yeah, Bill could preach it. Absolutely.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Bill. I don't think so. We'll save a copy. Since Martin's not here, we'll get that to him when he gets back. I do pray for Martin and for Kathleen. They've been gone for the last couple of Sundays. I know they had company last week. I'm not sure quite where they are this morning. For Mary as well. But continue to pray for those. Look around. Notice the folks who aren't here. And be in prayer for those folks. Norma and Bede have both had bouts of pneumonia recently. I know we prayed for Norma last week, and I talked to her. She said that she's feeling much better. She sounded good. She said, but how's Bede? And I said, I have no idea. I haven't talked to Bede. What's going on with Bede? And she said, well, he has pneumonia. And I said, I've not heard this. So I called Bede last night, and or Friday rather, and sure enough, Bede has pneumonia. So be in prayer for him. It's a lot harder to talk to Bede than it was to talk to Norma. He is at the beginning of dealing with it. She was toward the end. And so continue to pray for Bede, if you will. It's so good to have Sherry with us this morning. Sherry has gotten over, or is in the process of getting over knee replacement and getting ready for a new shoulder in the coming weeks. So, mercy lady. Wow. We'll certainly be praying for you. In addition to all the ways that we've normally been praying, certainly praying for you this morning as that comes up. We have so many needs, it seems like. This is the tip of the iceberg. We continue to pray for Choice and Joan as Choice came home from the hospital this week and chose to go into hospice care. A decision that he did not take lightly, a decision that for some in his family has been a difficult recognition, difficult realization. We'll certainly be in prayer for that family. We have so many, it seems like, who are continually dealing with grief or pain, whether physical or emotional, who are continually having to have the baggage that comes along with living in a world that's been twisted by sin. And so this morning, as we pray for one another, we remember that God is the one, the God who provides. God is the one who meets all of those needs, who is able to strengthen in every situation that we face. Let us pray. Father, this morning as we bow before you, before we bring any needs before you, before we ask for any, for your touch in any of these situations, we first of all recognize that, as we have already sung this morning, that you are the Holy One. You are the God who is righteous, who not only does all things right, but Lord God, who works in such a way to bring about what is right in the lives of your people, in the lives of the church. And so this morning, Father, we ask for your rightness to be done here, in this place, here, in us. Change us, Lord God. Mold us, shape us into your image. May your love, your holiness be reflected through our lives into the lives of everyone that we encounter. We thank you, Father, that you are the one who does provide. You are the one who meets needs. You are the one, Lord God, who meets us where we are, who knows the grief, the pain, the struggles that we face, whether those struggles are emotional or spiritual or physical. Father, you are aware, and you meet every need. You provide, Lord God, for every situation, and we thank you, Father. We do pray specifically for these, Father, this morning that we've mentioned. We do ask, Father, for your continued touch upon Bede, that you may touch and heal him, bring him back to full health and strength. We thank you, Lord God, for the ways that you have been healing Norma throughout her sickness. And we ask, Lord God, that you will restore her fully and bring her back to us again. We pray for Sherry. Lord, she's already been through so much. We ask, Father, that now you will provide her with the grace that she needs as she prepares for this next surgery. We ask, Father, that you will help her through this one. You have proven to be, once again, Father, the faithful God. And so we ask, Father, that your faithfulness will be seen and known as you work again in this situation for her. We ask, Lord God, that in all things, that you will be glorified. That you will be glorified here in this place this morning through the songs that are sung, through the words that are spoken. We pray, Father, that you will be glorified beyond these four walls, that you will be glorified in this community through your people, through us, through others, Lord God, who are hearing and responding to your voice and walking with you in faith. We pray, Father, this morning for those who are traveling, for Sam and Susan specifically, as Sam is preaching down in the Hill Country Church. We ask, Father, your blessings upon them as they travel again this afternoon. Bring them home safely to us. Father, in all things, we recognize that you are the Holy God. And we thank you for your presence with you. We thank you, Father, for your presence with us. And we ask, Father, for your continued grace. Hear us now as we join our hearts and our voices together, praying as Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Old Testament passage, Exodus, starting in chapter 34, verse 29. Now it was so, when Moses came down from Mount Sinai, and the two tablets of the testimony were in Moses' hand when he came down from the mountain, that Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone while he talked with God. So when Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moses, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him. Then Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the rulers of the congregation returned to him, and Moses talked with them. Afterward, all the children of Israel came near, and he gave them as commandments all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. And when Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, Moses would take the veil off until he came out, and he would come out and speak to the children of Israel whatever he had been commanded. And whenever the children of Israel saw the face of Moses, that the skin of Moses' face shone, then Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with God. Stand again, and let's sing together, Holy Ground.
We are standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now. Standing in his presence on holy ground. We are standing in his presence on holy ground. Standing on holy ground. I know that there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now. We are standing in his presence on holy ground. Presence on holy ground.
Amen. You can be seated.
Today is Transfiguration Sunday. I asked Rachel this morning, did you get me a card? Did you get me a card for Transfiguration Sunday? I think she then asked me if I got her a present. I didn't, so it was even. The reason I mentioned that today is Transfiguration Sunday is that I want you to think about this for a moment. Today, throughout the Christian church, throughout the global church, thousands of Christians, millions, perhaps, will be reminded of Jesus' revelation of his divine identity to Peter, James, and John on the Mount of Transfiguration. Think about that. It's not just us. It's not just a couple of churches in Robinson. It's not just a few churches here and there. Thousands. Multiple thousands, perhaps even millions of Christians around the world today, brothers and sisters in Christ, in from magnificent cathedrals to small churches to house churches to meeting underground because they know, meeting somewhere in a safe place because they know that at any moment authorities could come and break in and haul them away. It's just simply for declaring their faith as Christian. Today, around the world, many of our brothers and sisters in Christ are hearing about this same truth. I don't know about you, but that excites me. That reminds me that God's kingdom is so much bigger than what we normally think of. It's so much more than just this one little place. It's so much more than just this one little community. It's God's kingdom is global. God's kingdom is universal. That fact this morning has really grabbed a hold of my mind, grabbed a hold of my heart, and I pray this morning that it will yours as well. For the Transfiguration, for this revealing moment In the Gospels, this moment marks a point of change in Jesus' ministry. Suddenly, Jesus' ministry goes from being a public ministry with the healing and the teaching and the feeding of the thousands, and it goes to a much more private affair. It becomes focused in, for the most part, focused in upon the disciples. Jesus needs to prepare them for what's coming, to get them ready for Jesus' arrest, for his trial, for his crucifixion, and ultimately for resurrection. For we today, who are the modern followers of Jesus, this Sunday, this Transfiguration Sunday, marks the Sunday before the season of Lent. We'll hear more about Lent in the weeks to come, trust me. But for today, just remember this. Lent is the season of preparation before Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. When Lent is thought of as a time to prepare our spiritual lives for these coming events, in much the same way that Jesus used this time to prepare the disciples for what was about to come, Lent isn't that different from how Advent prepares us for the celebration of Jesus' birth. We approach this morning the Transfiguration from a little different angle than we usually do. Instead of joining Jesus and the disciples on the mountaintop, we turn instead to 2 Corinthians chapter 3 in order to hear what God, through Paul, tells us about the effect that knowing God has on our lives. This section of 2 Corinthians has bothered many scholars throughout the years because Paul seems to make an abrupt change in the things that he's been talking about here. Since the opening lines of this letter, truly all the way back since chapter 1, verse 3, maybe verse 4, Paul has been talking about suffering, about the pain of living in this world, about the issues that we face because of the way that sin has twisted everything around us, of how sin has turned upside down God's creation. And now the kingdoms of this world are fighting against the kingdom of God that is revealing itself through the church, through the lives of those who are responding to God's voice and trusting in Jesus. And so a lot of scholars ask, is this section that seems so out of place in what Paul has been talking about, suddenly he starts talking about Exodus and about Moses and about the revealing presence or the revealing of Moses' face in the presence of God shown in this way to the people of Israel. Is this a section of a different letter? Has it been put in the wrong place over the years? Is maybe this supposed to go in a different letter? Did Paul just simply get confused about what he was writing about and just all of a sudden change tacks and then come back in a little bit and talk about suffering again? Or is there something else going on? I have a tendency to think that there is something else going on, that there is a bigger picture, and we have to look at the entire letter of what Paul is writing here as opposed to just look at a tiny little section and pick each little section apart minutely. My prayer this morning is that as we jump into this passage, may God give us wisdom to understand God's actions through Jesus in this world and in our lives. We start in verse 7 this morning, 2 Corinthians 3, verse 7. Paul writes, "But if the ministry of death, written and engraved on stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the face of Moses because of the glory of his countenance, which glory was passing away, how will the ministry of the Spirit not be more glorious? For if the ministry of condemnation had glory, the ministry of righteousness exceeds much more in glory. For even what was made glorious had no glory in this respect because of the glory that excels. For if what is passing away was glorious, what remains is much more glorious." This is one of those passages where it seems like Paul is just talking in circles. We read this and we think, where is he going with this? What's the point of what he's talking about? I think, first of all, it's important for us to note what he has in mind here is the Exodus passage that we read just a few moments ago. It's the passage where Moses is coming down from Mount Sinai. Moses has been meeting with God and has received this second copy, if you will, of the Ten Commandments, of the Ten Words. This was the beginning of Torah. This is that way of describing and defining how God's people are set apart from the rest of the world. These Ten Commandments deal with our relationship with God and our relationship with everyone else around us. The first four deal with ourselves and God. The other six deal with ourselves and community, ourselves and how we approach the people around us, how we treat the people around us, how we react sometimes to the people around us. In all of these ways, God is telling us, as my people, you are meant to live in a way that is separate, a way that is different, a way that is unique from all the rest of the people in the world. It's important to note, Paul is not attacking or belittling this Old Testament passage here. Some folks have taught that over the years, that Paul, as a Reformed Jewish believer, is now saying, well, the Old Testament has no value. That's not true at all. It's not true at all. In fact, what Paul is doing with this passage instead is telling us this is an important passage because God here in Exodus, through the law, is revealing God's work of redemption. We see that God, in the book of Exodus, has provided the moral law, the Torah, for the Hebrew people. It was this Torah which showed the world that this group of people was called to be different from the other cultures that surrounded them. This group had been called into relationship with God. Torah also revealed, the practice of the law revealed that sin separated God, or separated humanity rather, from God. That God was calling us into relationship with himself, but there was a problem. There was an issue. And the issue came about because of sin. And so Paul goes on, verse 12. Therefore, since we have such hope, we use great boldness of speech, unlike Moses, who put a veil over his face, so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the end of what was passing away. Even though we said already this passage is important in what is revealed about God's character, Paul points out that the glory of God, which made Moses' face shine, was just a temporary thing. The Exodus passage tells us that Moses covered his face with a veil because the people were afraid to look at Moses. Paul says, also, in addition to the people being afraid, Moses covered his face because the glory of God that was shining from Moses' face was fading away. It was a temporary thing. Exodus says that Moses veiled his face because of the people being terrified. Paul again says the glory was fading, and Moses didn't want the people to recognize that. Both points, I think, are important. Both points are necessary. You see, the reflection of God's glory in the face of Moses brought terror to the people because this holy reflected light illuminated the people's own sinfulness. That's why the moral code was given. The practice of Torah became a way to provide a temporary covering to an issue that was not yet ready to be dealt with. The people saw the awesome glory of the holy God revealed in the face of Moses, and the people instantly knew the darkness of their spiritual condition meant they were unable to stand in God's presence. Just a few weeks ago, we looked at the passage of Scripture from Isaiah chapter 6, and Isaiah sees God in the temple, and the whole picture there is one of exceeding glory, of God's immense power, of God's immense holy presence. And Isaiah cries out, and he says, woe is me. I am undone. For I am a man of sinful lips who dwells in the midst of people who have sinful lips. And we saw there God's provision for Isaiah to be cleansed from that sin so that Isaiah could then proclaim God's truth. In this way, Moses, the lawgiver, has been affected, outwardly affected, by being in the presence of God. And the holy presence of God is shining out of Moses' very face, out of his character. Everything that the people see in Moses is not just Moses anymore, but it's overshadowed by the fact that God has done a work here. By being in God's presence, Moses has truly been in that, on that holy ground and in that holy presence of God that has brought about this change. But the change in Moses was not permanent. It was temporary. The glory faded. The access the Hebrew people had to God through the Torah was temporary, and it was meant to be temporary. Because if the practice of the moral law, if the ritual of the Jewish temple was able to cleanse from sin and restore relationship between God and humanity, then there would be no need to send Jesus. But the law, as Paul states over in the book of Romans, the law reveals the distance between the holy God and the sin-stained creation. The Torah, the moral law, revealed the need, but it was powerless to provide the clue, the cure. Paul goes on, verse 14. But their minds were blinded, for until this day, the same veil remains unlifted in the reading of the Old Testament, because the veil is taken away in Christ. But even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil lies on their heart. Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. For those who continue to reject God's salvation, this veil of fear and doubt and sinfulness remains. The Old Testament revelation of the holy, living God inviting humanity into relationship makes no sense. If that's only to be a temporary thing, why do it? Well, because the law reveals that there is a need. But then God says, let's go beyond that and let's send the cure. The Torah was not the cure, but Jesus is the cure. As Paul is writing here, he's thinking about his own countrymen and those others who hear this gospel message, and they reject the message. They reject what God has provided through Jesus. For them, for those who reject God, Paul says, there's no provision for the spiritual need of humanity. There is no freedom from sin. There's only additional bondage that we heap upon ourselves by saying, if I just work a little harder, I'll make myself good enough. If I can just clean myself up a little bit better, if I can just clean up my act, if other people will just think that I'm good enough, or, excuse me, as long as I can be better than somebody else. But that's not the point, Paul says. It's not about us comparing ourselves in performance to someone else. It's about always God holding up for us his standard of holiness and saying, this, my standard, is what you live by. It's impossible for us to clean ourselves up, to make ourselves a better person, to give enough out of ourselves in order for God's standard to be realized in our lives. It is impossible. There must be another way. And God says, or Paul says, now there is. Where the Lord is, there is liberty. This liberty is not just the liberty to do as we please. This is real freedom. This is the power to be released from the power of sin. This is the freedom that comes in Christ as we are abiding in Christ and He is abiding in us. It is that moral freedom that comes as our sins are forgiven, as the guilt of the past is washed away and cleansed away by the blood of Jesus that was shed on the cross. This is the freedom, the release. This is not just the freedom to act how we want. This is not just the freedom to run the aisles if we feel like it. This is the freedom of God in our lives to know that God has provided the way to be forgiven from sin. Through Jesus, God offers this cleansing. Thanks be to God for His wonderful gift. Paul goes on. If this is true, then how is it recognized in our lives? And so Paul goes on and he says this. He says, but we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. So in the same way that God forgives our sins through the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit, so too is God in this process of continuing to mold us, to shape us. That is the from glory, from the glory of being forgiven of our sins, from the glory of entering into relationship with God, to the glory of continuing in that relationship, from glory to glory. That is how God is at work. Chapter 4, verse 1, he moves on. Therefore, since we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we do not lose heart. And here's how all of this talk about transfiguration, all of this talk about God's work and God's redemption, this is how all of this talk ties us back into what Paul has been saying previously about suffering, about living in a world that is still rejecting God, about living in a world that continues to say, just eat, drink, and be merry, for there's nothing that we can do about it. Live for yourself. Put yourself first. Put everybody else aside. Paul says, no, that's not what God has revealed. It's not about us trying to be a better person. It's not about us at all. It's about God and about God inviting us and about whether or not we will respond to God's invitation. Paul moves on. Verse 2, we have renounced the hidden things of shame, the things that are put under the veil that nobody wants to talk about. We've renounced the shamefulness of this life. We're not walking in craftiness. We're not handling the word of God deceitfully. But by manifestation, by the making known of the truth, commending ourselves, putting ourselves out there as preachers, as witnesses, as people whose faces are glowing with the glory of God, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. Paul's saying, you know what? Things have been rough. I know that they're rough for you. They've been rough for me. Paul has just spent time in prison. I have no doubt that as he's writing this letter, he's remembering the shamefulness of how he was treated in prison. Probably the beatings of what occurred there, the ideas that have been passed around by other preachers to this Corinthian group, and saying, well, if God was really with Paul, would Paul be in prison right now? Paul says, we live in a world that's twisted and scarred by sin. We live in a world that hates God and has rejected God. So why wouldn't the world reject us as well? Just as the Hebrew people rejected Moses when they saw a reflection of God's glory in Moses' face, and that glory was temporary and passing away. So too, when people see a reflection of God in our lives from what God is doing, not just on the inside, not just on the outside, but inwardly, as God has forgiven our sins, as God is reshaping our spirits, as God is completing our lives spiritually, we can't help but shine. To shine with the good news of who God is and of what God has done in Christ. Our lives look differently. We're no longer folks who are ashamed of who we are, of what we're doing. We're not trying to be deceitful. We're not trying to be manipulative. We are people who boldly proclaim all that God has done and all that God is doing. It's not about me. It's about God. And about God's power to transform, God's power to remove the veil from our face, God's power to work in such a way that the glory of God that is shown is not a temporary fading thing, but a brand new reality for all who will walk with God through faith in Christ Jesus. Moses' face shone briefly with the reflected glory of God, but there was no lasting change brought by the Torah to Moses' heart or spirit. Through repentance from sin and response to God's voice, God brings that lasting change to the lives of those who continue in relationship with God. That isn't to say that our performance in all things becomes perfect. There will always be areas in our lives where God will need to be working on us. But God's work through Jesus does bring spiritual completion to all who respond to God's grace. Those who are completed, where God's Spirit abides in our human spirit, these become a living manifestation of God's truth and glory. In Christ Jesus, there is no longer the need for selfish manipulation or living with the shame of practicing sinfulness. God provides all cleansing from all sin for all who come to God. Just as God's glory shining from Moses' face frightened the Hebrew people, the glory of God's holiness shining from our lives can put off people who choose to remain in sin. And just as Jesus was transfigured before the disciples to reveal his divine glory, God brings transfiguration to our lives as we continue to walk with God through faith in Christ. We will suffer in this life, sometimes because of the things that we do, but often because the darkness of this worldly kingdom is fighting against the revealing, redeeming light of God and God's kingdom. And yet we continue on in Christ, knowing that the ministry to which God calls us is a ministry of unveiled face, a ministry which is revealing God's power and God's grace to everyone God brings into our path every single day. We have the opportunity this morning to share in communion with one another. And before we do, I'm going to ask you to stand and sing as our folks come back up on the platform. We're going to be singing together and then moving into our communion. Let's sing.
Stand, we'll sing hymn number 460. Let us break bread together. When I fall on my
to the rising sun. Oh Lord, have mercy on me. Let us praise God together on our knees. Let us praise God together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun, oh Lord, have mercy on me.
On the night of Jesus's betrayal, before he was arrested, while he was in the upper room with the disciples, during the meal, he took the bread and he said, "This bread represents my body, which will soon be broken for you. As often as you eat of it, remember me." Take and eat. At the end of the meal, at the end of the Passover meal they were sharing together, Jesus took the final cup, a cup that's often known as the cup of Elijah, the cup of that which God is still doing, a cup of that reminds us of what God is providing. And he raised the cup and he said, "This cup represents my blood which will soon be shed for the forgiveness of your sins. Take and drink." Let us pray. Father God, these elements, these symbols, remind us of a far greater truth. And it's not through the eating and the drinking that you cleanse us from sin. It's through remembering. It's through relationship. It's through responding to your voice, walking with you by faith. You, Lord God, are at work in us, helping us to know you, to trust you. Father, you've brought us here this morning to hear again this message of the gospel. You've reminded us, Father God, that those outward things that pass away so quickly, those are not the standard by which we measure our lives. Our life, the worth of who we are, Lord God, is found in Christ. It's measured, Lord God, as we are walking with you. And so this morning, Father, we ask for you to help us, shape us, mold us, shine your truth, your holiness, your holy love through us, Lord God, that others may see you and be drawn to you. Thank you, Father, for the work that you are doing. Go with us now as we leave this place. And in all ways, Lord God, may you be glorified in us and through us. In Jesus' name. Let's sing.
We'll sing "Change My Heart, O God." Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me, this is what I my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God.